Hello guys, today we will talk about lower urinary tract symptoms and I think it's really interesting but not spend your time. Don't really spend your time. At first we will talk about benign prostatic hyperplasia and benign prostatic hyperplasia is commonly seen in older men, affecting more than 80% of men in their 80s. As men age, there is normal increase in the amount of prostatic stroma and smooth muscle tone, which may ultimately result in bladder outlet obstruction, BOO. In contrast to prostate cancer, which tends to in the peripheral zone of the prostate and therefore rarely presents with local symptoms. BPH occurs in the periurethral transition zone and therefore rarely affects voiding. BPH can result in a range of symptoms, including weak and or intermittent stream, hesitancy, terminal dribbling, and nocturia. Patients may also have poor bladder emptying. In the long term, the bladder may become overworked, manifesting either with urgency and frequency from detrusor overactivity, or with inadequate contractions leading to retention or overflow incontinence. Investigation. When assessing patients with lower urinary tract symptoms, it is important to establish if their symptoms are prostatic in origin or if they may be other underlying pathology or contribution factors. A through history should be taken and examination including all the prostate, rectum, and urinalysis performed in all. A bladder diary is available tool to gain insights into patients' voiding patterns and likely etiology. Ultrasound. A urinary tract ultrasound is not essential for investigation of all cases of lower urinary tract symptoms, but can be helpful in triaging patients by identifying complications of BPH, presence of gyponephrosis or bladder calculi. Also, prostate size does not correlate with patient symptoms. These informations can be useful in guiding appropriate BPH treatment selection. And there you see, bladder, yes, and prostate. And what you need to remember, guys, that when we use ultrasound, we can use ultrasound at skin, and we can use ultrasound inside, from rectum, per rectum. And it is more informativity ultrasound if we will do it per rectum. Transretral ultrasound, TRU, transretral ultrasound. Okay, poor voiding flow rate supports a diagnosis of BOO. However, in complex cases where it is unclear if poor flow is due to obstruction or detrusor failure, formal urodynamic testing will confirm high detrusor pressure in the setting of BOO. For men with a life expectancy of 10 years or more, testing for prostate-specific antigens should be considered because a diagnosis of prostate cancer may change treatment choices. the decisions to treat which largely comes down to the degree of inconvenience the patient experiences. If a man is not bothered by his lower urinary tract symptoms, it is responsible to defer treatment in most cases, as not all patients with BPH will have progression of their symptoms. For most men with BPH, medical management will be first line. Alpha blockers and 5-alpha reductase inhibitors are the mainstay of pharmacological management, either alone or in combinations, of course. Let's talk about alpha blockers. Act by relaxing the smooth muscle of the bladder, neck and prostate, with symptom improvement noted within a few days of initial of treatment. They are generally well tolerated with relatively few side effects. Retrograde eyaculation, dizziness and postural hypotension. Hypotension is now seen less frequently as selective alpha blockers, such as tamsulosin, target only the alpha-1A receptor subtype localized to the bladder. And there you can see that alpha-1 can be on walls of blood vessels, midriasis, fluid dilatation, eyaculation, and in urinary retention, but alpha-1A are just in urinary retention. Sparing the alpha-1B receptor located in blood vessels. Which caused trouble some hypotension with previous generation non-selective drug. That means that if you're using alpha-1 blockators, you can lead to hypertension. But if you're using selective alpha-1A alpha blockers, like Tamsulosin. It is selective alpha-1A blockers, and we need to use it for patients. And the next one is 5-alpha reductase inhibitors. It's drugs like finasteride, like propecia, and like dutasteride, like Avodart. They block the conversion of testosterone to dehydrotestosterone, which result in reduction of prostate volume over time. This ultimately leads to improvement of urinary flow as well as reduction in risk of urinary retention and need for surgery. However, due to the mechanism of action, noticeable symptom improvement is generally only achieved after 6 or 9 months of treatment. Surgical relief. An absolute indication for surgical relief of obstruction is the presence of hip nephrosis and renal impairment due to high pressure retention. It's called obstructive uropathy. Other indications for surgical intervention include voiding symptoms refractory to medical therapy, recurrent urinary retention, infections, gross hematuria, or blood recalcitrant. And first type of and most common type of surgery is transurethral resection of the prostate. TURP is considered the gold standard for surgical management of BPH. It involves endoscopic resection of the prostate using a cutting diatomy loop to shave away chips of prostate to leave a wide open prostatic fossa. Potential complications include bleeding, infection, retrograde eyaculation, stretching, and transurethral resection syndrome. Collection of symptoms like signs including hyponatremia, hypervolemia, hypertension, nausea, vomiting, visual disturbance, and altered conscious state due to excess absorption of hypotonic irrigation fluid. Another types of surgical relief. Also, TURP still remains and mainstay in many urology practices. Other surgical options also exist. In small prostates where there is simply a tight bladder neck, the bladder neck may be incised endoscopically without formal resection any tissue. Very large prostates may be more safely and effectively treated with an open simple prostatectomy to enucleate the adenomatous tissue, leaving behind the prostate capsule. The threshold to elect for open surgery will vary from surgeon to surgeon. Also, a prostate volume of in excess of 100-150 cm would be considered too large for TURP by many. As technology and surgical expertise advance, lasers are being used to tackle glands that were previously considered too large for endoscopic intervention. Lasers can be used to easily vaporize BPH tissue. It's called green light photoselective vaporization of the prostate, usually utilized in small to moderate size glands, or enucleate the prostate, holmium laser enucleation of the prostate, which achieves a similar outcome to open prostatectomy in large glands with reduced blood loss. One of the drawbacks of laser therapies is a high rate of irritative voiding symptoms post-operatively. And there you can see on pictures enucleate of the prostate, yes, is it called holmium laser enucleation. And green light photoselective you can see there. Another problem after BPH is urethral stricture. And stricture is an abnormal narrowing, and in the urethra, this obstructs the usual passage of urine, leading to a weak flow. Some patients may also describe spraying or a double urinary stream, as well as frequency, dysuria or hematuria. And there you see a stricture. Yes, narrow. Acquired urethral strictures are common in men and are usually due to previous infection or trauma such as catheterization, surgical instrumentation, or external trauma such as a straddle injury or pelvic fracture. And when we talk about infection, we need to understand that we talk about gonococcal urethritis in common cases. And then retrograde urethrography is important in evaluating these patients, as it will demonstrate the extent and location of any stricture and can help get management. What about management? Urethral irritation or urethrotomy endoscopic incisional stricture will usually relieve any symptoms, but in many cases the stricture will recur. And there you can see urethral irritation when we use something in urethra and increase the size of urethra with mechanic. And urethrotomy you can see there where we do some incisions with urethrotomy. Urethroplasty involves formal repair of the stricture and has a higher chance of long-term access. And there you can see urethroplasty. For short strictures, excision of the stricture with end-to-end anastomosis may be used, but longer strictures require grafting of the affected area, usually with buccal mucosa. And if you can see there, we cut the place where we have a stricture and do anastomosis between two urethra ending. And the last one is the self-catheterization. It's alternatively for patients who don't want to operation and they can keep the urethral lumen with intermittent self-catheterization. And the last symptom is of lower urinary tract disease is nocturia. And nocturia is defined as waking once or more at night to void. Also, it is commonly related to BPH in men. There are many other causes that must be considered. These causes can be grouped into three broad categories. Polyuria, first category, the second nocturnal polyuria, and the third bladder capacity problems. When we talk about polyuria, we need to talk about voided volume more than 2,800 milliliters per 24 hours. Nocturnal polyuria amount voided overnight is more than one third the daily total volume, which may be due to behavioral issues or underlying medical disease. And bladder capacity problems included BOO, overactive bladder, and neurogenic bladder. Management need to be directed at the underlying causes. And that's all about today's topic. Thanks for your attention and be healthy. Bye bye.